Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the another edition of the Smart Residence Learning Program. Today, where we have a very important topic about scientific writing being delivered by none other than the chair, the editor of the Indian Journal of Urology, Dr. Rajiv Kumar, who is also the academic dean at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences. He's going to tell us all about scientific writing, which is very important because if you have to survive now, you have to do a lot of publications. And I think this would be very useful for the residents. With this opening remarks, I would now invite Dr. Rajiv Sood, who is the chair, ISU, to give his remarks. Over to you, Dr. Rajiv Sood.
Thank you, Keshav. Greetings from Indian School of Urology. Today's topic, as has been already told, is the core of the entire learning and also transmission of the data accumulated, data process, and how to present it. And it is not only the important skill which is to be imbibed by each and every resident and also consultants as well. We have now Dr. Rajiv Kumar, who is the editor of our journal, and also he is doing wonderfully his activities about this scientific writing, statistics, how to involve data processing. In all the aspects he has been teaching, he is from All India Institute of Medical Sciences, and also he is associated with the Urological Society of India and many other associations like Asian or maybe SIU and many other places. He has been invited. He has taught many residents, many lectures, workshops he has conducted. And therefore, today's lecture is actually related to each and every edition of USI Resident for Smart Learning Program, because ultimately all the scientific data is to be properly arranged and processed and also presented, and there should not be any plagiarism. It has become the essential part of the protocol submission, thesis writing. You have to give the certificate. Dr. Rajiv is going to tell us about everything, including impact factor and what are the predatory journals. I was with him as examiner in one of the exam, and he was asking the residents and they were not able to answer. So this is a very good opportunity. All the aspects of writing and importance of writing is taking up today for the residents, and I'll request all the residents to be attentive and be interactive. Also, chat box is there at the end. Dr. Arun Chawla is also going to coordinate the entire question answers or later on the activities what all the residents have understood. So let us start our program. Back to Dr. Keshav Murthy.
Thank you, Professor Sood. Now I would invite Dr. Arun Chawla to introduce the speaker and moderate the session. Over to you, Dr. Arun.
Thank you, sir. It's my present duty to introduce Dr. Rajiv Kumar to our agents and other colleagues who have logged in. Dr. Rajiv Kumar is currently professor in urology and is associate in academics at prestigious Institute of AIIMS, New Delhi. Regarding his little background of his area of interest, he has great inclination towards minimal invasive urology, both laparoscopy and robotics. He has penchant for etiology of male infertility and likes to perform different microsurgical procedures for male infertility. And in fact, has done many workshops and programs under the aegis of different zones and our parent institution of Urology Society of India. Many international and national publications to his credit, and his academic honors and awards include Urology Gold Medal for Best Postgraduate in AIIMS 2001, Institute Medal for Best Graduate in AIIMS 1993, Institute Merit Scholarship from AIIMS again from 1990 to 1994. Various other important awards include the International Surgical Education Scholarship from American College of Surgeons in 2014, International Guest Scholarship, Outstanding Young Urologist, prestigious Chakrabarti Fellowship and MUC Fellowship from Urology Society of India. And he has delivered very prestigious oration and endowment lectures, Pinamani Venkateshwara Rao Oration at USI, USICON 2020, Professor P.V. Sivaraman Endowment Guest Lecture at the Annual Conference of Association of Southern Urologists in 2016. Currently, he is the Chief Editor, Indian Journal of Urology. My dear friends, teachers and residents, Dr. Rajiv Kumar has been instrumental in keeping the standard of Indian Journal of Urology very high. He has been with various assignments and responsibilities from other international journals and organizations. He is scientific co-chair from SIU, scientific chairman of Urology Association of Asia, associate editor, National Medical Journal of India, international consulting editor, Journal of Urology, associate editor, International Journal of Urology, and assistant editor, Journal of Endourology. With this background, you can understand well how useful will be today's class for you all. In today's class, we'll learn why we should publish and how to write what you can say the emerald skeleton of an article. Common errors during writing and important reason of rejection from the journals will be highlighted. And he will also make you aware about the plagiarism and various pediatric journals. With this, I have great pleasure in handing over to Dr. Rajiv Kumar for carrying on the proceedings. I request you to stay proactive and note down the points, note down the question, put in the chat box. And I request Rohit, Vinod, Anshuman, and Naman to stay unmuted. Dr. Rajiv Kumar, in between, may like to ask question or like to have interaction during his course of presentation. Please stay unmuted and with video on. Thank you. And over to you, Dr. Rajiv.
Dr. Sood, Dr. Keshamurthy, Dr. Chawla, thank you very much for both asking me to be here today and also for that unexpectedly kind introduction. I didn't expect you to spend so much time here. So thank you very much. It's always a pleasure to speak about publication and writing. And I hope the residents take away something useful from what I have to say over the next few minutes. It would be useful if there are people who are able to ask their questions and clear their doubts. A 1 hour lecture is extremely painful. And nobody can sit through a 45-minute or a 50-minute lecture without falling asleep. So it would be useful if they wanted, if they had questions, they could ask something as silly as, why can I not write this? Or why should I write this? Nothing is silly, nothing is stupid. Ask any question you feel that comes to your mind. And I'll try my best to answer. I'm going to share my screen. Is this visible now?
Yes.
Yes, yes.
Able to see my screen?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Right, thank you. Right, so we will be talking about, because I've broken down this talk into multiple aspects of how to write an article. We're going to cover things like, why is it important to write? What is the standard format of an article? I'll give you some practical tips on how to write each section and common errors that creep up, which will come up with each section as you write. And finally, we'll talk a little bit about understanding plagiarism and a little bit about predatory journals. So let's begin with the most basic question. Why should you even write? What is the reason that you should even write an article? The commonest answer probably would be, I don't have a choice. I'm working as a PG, I'm doing a DNB or an MCH, and my boss wants me to write an article, so I don't have a choice. I just have to do it. That's a valid answer. Unfortunately, that's a part of the job that you are doing, that you do have to write just because your boss asks you to do it. But is there a reason for writing other than just because your boss wants you to do it? Do you want to do it for yourself? And therefore, we're going to cover a little bit about the inside story, both about why I think you should be writing and also about how to go about doing it so it doesn't come back with 20 rejections every time you submit a paper. That's the bottom line of what we're trying to do today. So why do we ever write? I normally look at it from two perspectives. There are two principal reasons why people write. The first reason is the real reason why journals and articles ever began, and that's an altruistic reason. We began writing to benefit mankind. we used to do research, we used to do some work, and at the end of doing that work, we realized that something new had happened. Somebody discovered penicillin, somebody discovered another antibiotic, somebody discovered a cancer cure. And the only way to tell the entire community of what was happening was to write, was to make a publication. So the principal idea at that time was altruism, to benefit mankind, to do good, and to prevent harm. And the picture you see here is one of the first medical journals ever published. That's almost 350 years ago. And this journal is published even today. So that's why writing became an important aspect of what we did. When you work in a country like India, writing is even more important than we would ever imagine it to be. There is something called the 1090 gap. What the 1090 gap means is that less than 10% of the research funds go towards diseases that actually affect 90% of the population. Do you get funding for chyluria? Do you get funding for tuberculosis? Well, TB you might still get it. Chyluria, you won't get any funding. Stricture urethra, will you get funding? VVF, will you get funding? It doesn't happen. On the other hand, you write a problem, you get funding. This is the gap. The diseases that affect us go unreported, go uncovered in the published literature. We don't get funded, we don't publish. And therefore, it's assumed that our diseases don't exist. That's why it's even more important for us in regions where the disease spectra are different to publish our work. Only then would people realize that this is important and it would get its due recognition. The other most important aspect of this writing for altruism is that I believe it's a fundamental responsibility of every resident in particular, but a consultant also, to question dogmas. Don't accept anything that you are told just because somebody wearing a coat and a tie, maybe in a white skin, maybe with a 50-year-old age, tells it to you that this is the right way of doing it. Question everything. Ask question every dogma that you're told. And if you think something is wrong, you think something needs to be done, voice an opinion. One of the most important aspects that we want our residents to learn on our rounds is to use their brains. Think about why we are doing what we are doing. Think about the consequences and ask questions. Don't do it just because a consultant told you. Ask questions. Why am I doing it? Why should I not be doing it in another way? Can we do it better? And the only way you can make your voice heard is by writing your experience. That's why we've moved away from eminence-based medicine to evidence-based medicine. Just because an eminent personality says something should be done isn't how it should be done. You need to generate evidence. And for that, you need to write. And in order to be able to read, to write, you also need to be able to read. And that's what your journal clubs are meant for. It's only when you understand how writing and research is to be done and you learn critical appraisal that you would be able to write. That to me is one aspect of why we always write. Now let's come to the second aspect, and that's just as important. And that's the importance of personal recognition. Why do all of us want to get posts in various societies? Why do we want to be called to give lectures at various meetings? It doesn't give us money. You become a vice president or a president of a society, it doesn't give you any money. You'll actually end up spending from your pocket. You get called to give lecture at a meeting again, you're not going to make any money. You're actually going to spend from your pocket. Why do we do this? We crave recognition. And that's normal. That's natural. There's nothing wrong with it. We need to announce our existence. And there are some of us who work in academia who also need these publications for our progress. The money aspect of it is unfortunately also true, but that's not the primary motive. But this recognition is a very important motive, and it's an absolutely valid, genuine motive. You must aspire for it. You must be that golden egg. Today, there are more than 400 urologists that are being produced across this country. How does anybody know who you are? How does anybody recognize your value and your worth? You have to stand out, and not stand out by knocking your own thumb. You need to stand out by doing something substantive. I try to dichotomize things, I again see two ways of achieving that recognition. The first way of achieving that recognition is by simply claiming recognition. Telling everybody that I am a celebrity 100 times may get people to believe that you indeed are a celebrity. You're visible on various social media platforms. You're visible on various meetings, conferences, and people truly believe that you are a celebrity. That's one way of being called a celebrity. That's the easy path. This is the more difficult path. The more difficult path is where you write, where you publish, and where you establish your academic authority, and only then do you get recognition. So the path from academic recognition or your publications to celebrity is possible. The other way around doesn't work. And while the former is easier, the calling yourself a celebrity is easier, your sphere of influence is very limited. It's just about maybe people in your region, maybe people in your country will recognize you. But if you need recognition at an international platform, if you want to be recognized by your peers all across the world, the only way to achieve that is through publications. And I say this from experience. I have been sitting as a scientific co-chair for the SIU for the last 4 years and for the UA for the last 4 years. I develop their programs. We select people who will speak. We select people who will chair. And the single most important criteria that we look for are publications, because we don't know most of those people. You may be well known in your community. Everybody recognizes XYZ in their community. But outside your community, nobody knows XYZ. The only way we would know you is from what you've published. And therefore, the only way to get recognition truly is to publish. The other important aspect of publication is, of course, that papers influence practice. What we do today in medicine is based on what we have read in a paper, which then got converted into a guideline, which then went into a book chapter. That's a normal passage of recognition of evidence. At the same time, bad papers harm people. If you've done something wrong, if your paper isn't honest, and you've written something which is dishonest, it may influence practice. The other important aspect of medical writing is that there's no verification. When you say, I operated on 1,000 patients and I found 980 of them did well, who is ever going to come and check that you actually operated on 1,000 patients? You say, we did. It goes through a peer review. Once it gets published, nobody even questions you. Were there actually 1,000 or were there just 100? And you added a zero at the end of every figure. You may think it makes no difference, but it does make a huge difference. Because although punishments are rare, punishments do happen. Unfortunately, these are all people of Indian origin who published outstanding papers at the beginning of the pandemic last year and brought immense disrepute both to their associations and to the country. Therefore, although punishments are uncommon, if you do intentionally give out wrong information, you will be held responsible at some point of time. So what we've talked about here is the importance of publication. What we now need to talk about is how do you go about doing that publication. So the first cardinal principle of writing a paper is that you must have something to write. There must be something that you wish to say. Only then is it worth writing. The only people who are able to say something without having anything to say are politicians. Everybody else has to have something valid in order to be able to write. So your research question must be valid. What you're talking about must have some scientific validity, some novelty, something new. Even if it's just reiterating the old established data, there must be some value to what you're saying. And once you've decided that there is some research, some study that's a valid question that I might have to answer, the next important aspect is you must say it, which means you must write it briefly, you must write it absolutely completely, and it must be easy to understand. Remember, if you had to use a thesaurus or a dictionary to find a word to write in your manuscript, everybody else will have to do the same thing. If you've quoted a scientific, if you've quoted a statistical method that you have no idea what it means, I guarantee it to you, none of your readers also have any idea what it means. Therefore, it's important for you to present it in a manner that your audience is also able to understand it. The other important caveat, and this is a caveat that I think works everywhere in life. It's not just about writing, it's about everything you do. And that's about using what we call checklists. All right, let's have a brief interlude here. How many people have heard of this book or read this book? I don't know whether we can take polls. I don't think we can take polls. Maybe we'll see you in the chat box. You can put it there. How many people have read this book? If you haven't read this book, I would strongly advise you to read it. Atul Gawande is a surgeon. He's an endocrine surgeon at the Mass General. I think he's at Binghamton Women's right now. And he's written a number of these books, which are extremely important on general practice of medicine, and they also translate into life. And this one about the Checklist Manifesto created checklists for various surgical procedures and was also the basis for the creation of the WHO surgical checklist. Why I show this to you is that the use of checklists at various points, wherever you work, are very important because they ensure that you've covered all the questions that are likely to be answered. So when you come to the checklist for writing a paper, the paper consists of four important parts. It's called IMRAD, Introduction, Methods, Results, Discussion. Now, IMRAD applies to every type of writing, whether it's a case report, a review article, an original article, a systematic review, a letter to the editor. Every single piece of writing can be broken down into an IMRAD. And I will give you examples if I have time towards the end of what do I mean when I say that even a letter to the editor should follow an IMRAD structure. What does IMRAD mean? It basically puts your research into perspective. So the first question anybody will ever ask you is, why are you ever telling me this? Why did you do this research? All right, so you decided to do this research. What did you do? What did you find? And therefore, why should I bother to read it? What does it mean for me? Now, this is a normal conversation way of understanding how a paper should be written. You have to first tell your readers why the research was done. What did you do in that research? What did you find? And why is it important to them? Why should they even spend their time reading it? These four questions are called IMRAD. And now let's look at each one of them point-wise with the checklist. The introduction, to my mind, is one of the most important aspects of the manuscript because this is what introduces your manuscript to your readers. It's also what causes the engagement between the writer and the reader. We often tend to skip over the introduction part of it because we don't think it's very important. But to me, it's one of the most important things because it sets out the rules for why your research is important. Why was your study important? And again, breaking it down into checklist, I would advise you to answer three questions when you're writing your introduction. Break it down into three parts. Part one, what is the problem? What is the extent of the problem? So you could very well say BPH is an important problem, or you could say techniques of operating on a BPH are multiple and we don't know which one is good. You could also, let's say, look at strictures. We know that there are numerous ways of operating strictures and we don't know which one is good. So the problem, what is the extent of the problem, is part one. Part two of the introduction is, what is the part piece of information about this problem that we don't know? So we know strictures are common, but we don't know what is the best way of handling a 4 centimeter long stricture in the pendular urethra. So known problem, stricture urethras are common. What we don't know is how should we treat a 4 centimeter long stricture in the pendular urethra. So the second part is, what is the knowledge gap? The third part is, okay, so you've told me there is a problem. You told me what is the problem. What are you going to do about it? What is the study going to do about it? That's part three. What are you going to do about it? So I'll again break it down into a simple two-sentence thing. Stricture urethras are common. Managing strictures of about 4 centimeters in length in the pendular urethra is a problem, and there are multiple techniques, and we don't know which technique is good. Therefore, we decided to evaluate technique A versus technique B in a randomized trial to see which is better. That's the introduction. You've covered all three aspects of the questions. So it needs to be concise, not the practical aspects of writing the introduction. How long is it going to be will often depend upon which journal you're writing for. So if you're writing for, let's say, the Journal of Urology, it's only going to be read by urologists and everybody knows what a stricture is. So you don't have to describe X and X mummies found a stricture and stricture is a narrowing of the urethra and stuff like that. That's ridiculous. It's not required for the Journal of Urology. On the other hand, if you were writing for a regular normal journal, let's say the National Medical Journal of India, which is a general medicine journal, then you would have to say narrowing of the urethra can happen. It is difficult to treat. So the length of your introduction would vary with who you're writing for, what is your audience, and what is the type of your article. And it must always be focused, bringing down from a broader problem, which was a stricture urethra, to the narrower problem, which is management of a 4 centimeter anterior urethral stricture. So start from the broad point and come down to the narrower point. Don't begin with a history. If you're describing your experience of laparoscopic nephrectomy, don't say X, Y, and Z, describe the first nephrectomy. We still get papers today which says Ralph Clement did the first laparoscopic nephrectomy in 1992. We still get those papers where the introduction begins with that. And I'm sure Dr. Clement himself doesn't want any more citations to that first paper of his. The introduction is written always in the present tense. Typically, it constitutes less than 20% of the total length of your paper. Don't fill it up with references. Put in only the key references that you need to substantiate your claims. And don't repeat everything that you're going to write in your discussion section. So here's an example of what I think is a very good introduction. This is from the PIVOT study. So hang on, this shouldn't have gone back. Okay, let's see if I can minimize something here. Okay, right. So if you look at this introduction, it shows all three questions. Treatment of early stage prostate cancer is controversial. That's the problem. Prostate cancer and its treatment is controversial. We have two randomized trials which showed one treatment was better than the other. However, we are not sure whether intervention helps or not. That's the knowledge gap. Despite excellent long-term disease-specific survival, we don't have any trial comparing observation with surgery. That's the knowledge gap. Part three, therefore, we did a randomized trial comparing observation with radical prostatectomy. So all three aspects of the introduction that I talked about are covered in these three sentences. Another easy way of looking at what I think is a good introduction is what I call the first and the last line concept. Again, from the same study, the PIVOT study. Even if a lay person, let's say a gastroenterologist was reading this paper, I would expect he would understand what the paper is about. It clearly states that the treatment of prostate cancer is controversial. Therefore, we did a randomized trial to compare observation versus surgery. Any medical person, even a non-medical person, will probably understand what this paper was all about. And that's the beauty of a good introduction. This is, again, something which I often show in many of my presentations. This is the introduction that came from the Watson and Crick paper on DNA. It's just two sentences long, but it covers all the important aspects, all three questions. Go back and do it as a homework. You'll see how all three questions are covered. So that's the introduction. If you have any questions, you can just pipe in. I'm using a presentation more, so I can't actually see the chat box here. But I can see a chat box here. Let me just see if there are questions. You can put it there. I'll try and answer. Otherwise, all right. So I see a question here. I'll just take it and then move forward. Why do Indian journals often get rejections without editorial review from? Why do Indian authors often get rejections without editorial review from international journals? All right, I'll answer this question for you. Indian authors get rejection from Indian journals also without an external review. International authors also get rejections from international journals and from Indian journals without getting a peer review. Most manuscripts that come into a journal, about 50 to 60% of them will be rejected in-house by a good journal, which means the only person who's reading them is the editor and maybe the associate editor. And that's enough to make a decision. It won't go out for peer review. And I promise you that the number of internationals we reject is almost the same in terms of percentage as the nationals we reject in-house. So there is truly no bias just because it's a national or international. Then there's another question on the chat box. How can we publish in high impact journals and what are the key steps? Okay, so for that, you have to sit through the next 30 minutes. That hopefully you would know how you can publish in high impact journals. Now let's talk about the methods section. For an editor and a reviewer, the methods section is the single most important part of your paper. This is usually the most common place where manuscripts fail. We publish papers because they answer a scientific question. That's the basic objective, because you've raised a scientific question and you're going to answer that question. That's why a paper gets published. Your methods section tells us how you answered that question. And if the methods are such that we believe that this methodology can't answer the question, then your paper is dead. And therefore, to most editors and reviewers, the first thing they would read after understanding your objectives is how you actually went about answering your objectives. It's also what we call the commonest fatal flaw, because it is something which you cannot change after you've done your research. Your methodology was written even before you started your research. So if you did not do your work before starting your research, which means at the time of writing your thesis protocol, in the time of submitting it for ethics approval, if you didn't design it well at that time, it's going to be very difficult to salvage it at the time of writing the manuscript. So it has to be done a priori, right at the beginning. And that's again why we repeatedly tell residents, spend the maximum amount of time in designing the methodology at the time of writing your thesis protocol. Because the mess that you make then will not be recoverable when you send out to writing your paper. The methods tell us whether your research question can even be answered. Let's assume you wanted to compare complications of dorsal only urethra. I've decided to do structural urethra today. We pick up various topics to discuss in various talks. So today, let's do structural urethra as an example. So let's assume you decided to do a dorsal only urethroplasty versus a lateral only urethroplasty as your study. And you wanted to send the patient home on day 5 of surgery. You've called him back for catheter removal on day 14 and you have not seen him again for 7 months. Or you've only seen him once again for 1 month and you haven't seen him after that. You can't assess complications because you know the structural urethra, while he is admitted in the hospital, you aren't going to pick up complications of the procedure itself. You only pick up operative complications. Therefore, if your methodology can't answer the questions that you originally set out to answer, your paper is dead. Therefore, again, a very important practical advice. Go to a website called equatornetwork.org, equatornetwork.org. It has a large number of reporting guidelines. You must have heard of statements like CONSORT, PRISMA, STARD. These are guidelines which tell you that if you're writing a randomized trial, your paper should have the following points. To me, this is like knowing the question paper before the exam. Your exam is getting your paper published. The question paper is that you must have answers to the CONSORT guidelines. All those questions must be given. Why don't you read the CONSORT guideline when you're designing your study? If you read the CONSORT guidelines when you're designing your study and submitting it for ethics approval, you already know what questions the reviewer is going to ask you when you submit the paper. So read the question paper right at the time of joining the course. That's the best way of knowing what to study and what to answer. So pull out the guidelines right at the time of designing your research protocol. That's the best way of ensuring that you will be able to answer these questions when you write up your paper. So when you actually come down to writing the methods, you must put in as much information as is possible for somebody else to repeat the study. So who were your patients? How did you select? What do you mean by stricture? How did you diagnose the stricture? Why? How did you exclude traumatic strictures? How did you exclude inflammatory strictures? How did you assess the length? All details, which would be essential to ensure who is coming in into the study, must be given. The other important thing you must mention is how did you measure the outcome? Let's say your outcome was success. How do you define success in a urethroplasty? What do you mean by success? Does it mean what does the penis look like at the end of the surgery? Is that your definition of success? If so, how did you define a good cosmetic outcome? Is there a scale? Who measured it? On the other hand, if you're saying my success of urethroplasty means no intervention for 2 years, state it. No intervention including a dilatation or a cystoscopy was permitted. Anybody who required a dilatation or a cystoscopy was deemed a failure. Or I did uroflowmetries and uroflowmetry above X was considered a success. So how did you measure your outcome? The more objective it is, the more easy it is to interpret your study. Many things can't be objective. There are many things which are subjective. But then even a semi-quantitative assessment, which is why you have things like visual analog scale, you have Likert scales to assess subjective outcomes. So the more measurable you make your outcome, the more likely it can be assessed for validity. That's what's called the tools and the endpoints, and of course, then your statistics. So again, practical tips on the method section. It's the easiest part to write because by the time you come to writing your paper, the methods is already written in the protocol. So it's not difficult to write the methods. Write it first, read your protocol. It should not change from what you wrote in your protocol. The methods are always in the past tense. All information that you knew before you started writing your paper is methods. So let's say you wanted to recruit 100 subjects in your study and you decided at the time of starting the study that I will recruit 100 subjects. Then the 100 subjects are a part of methods. We decided to recruit 100 subjects, whatever may be the reason you chose 100. That's methods. On the other hand, if you said we did a prospective study starting from January 2018 to January 2021. And at the end of that period, you realize that you've now got 100 patients. Then that 100 patients will come in the results, not in the methods. If you knew upfront that I'm going to recruit 100 patients, it's methods. If the only thing you knew is that I'm going to recruit everybody who comes to me in the next 2 years, and it turns out that that was 100 at the end of 2 years, then that 100 comes in the results. So simple way of assessing it is everything you knew before you started the study is methods. Everything else you came to know after you did the study is results. And this is a very important aspect because people often overlap the two parts. Check for PICO. PICO means patients, intervention, comparison, and outcome. I won't go into details here because this is more about research methodology. And most importantly, don't make any variations in your methods and endpoints. Like I said, if you wanted to measure success of erythroplasty and you're measuring it on a Likert scale, you're saying the patient told me whether it was successful or not. That's a variation. You can easily measure success by urophimetry. You can do a retrograde erythrogram, lack of intervention. There are more objective ways. So don't base it on a Likert scale. Patient says, I'm happy, therefore I said my erythroplasty is successful. May not be a very good idea. Then we come to the results part. The results part is where you have to write down, all the answers that you decided you would do in the method section. So if the method section, you said, I want to calculate 5 endpoints. I want to calculate uroflow happiness on the basis of Likert scale, upper tract deterioration, or whatever be your points. If you said, I'm going to measure 4 things. If in your method you said, I want to measure 4 things, in your results, you must give answers to all 4 things. If anything is missing, there is a problem. Your reviewer will think you're trying to hide something. You may have found additional things. You may want to find that we also found that we had a high incidence of HIV in our patients. We weren't looking for it, but we just found that a high number of patients have HIV. It's important. Put it in the results. No harm done. But then in your methods, you must have said that testing for HIV was a routine part of our all in-hospital patients. So your results must be validated by your methods. If you say I found X, your method must say that you had actually collected that data. Only then could you have found X. And everything you said in your methods must be given. Make sure you check for accuracy. If you recruited 100 subjects, it must be 100 everywhere. It can't be 98 and 101 because that just means that you are not very smart. So check for accuracy. If the number that you're giving is less than 100, it's usually better to write the number 76, 88. If it's more than 100, we usually use percentage, but this is variable. This is not very rigid. Use figures and tables where you need to. So if you're showing a flow or a process, that's called a figure, and we call that the drama part of dorsal only compared to 84% with lateral only. Write that in the text. Overlap between your text and table. Don't give the same information in text and table and figure. Give it only at one place. Remember, I said are you able to hear me again?
Yeah, we can hear you, but the slides.
I kind of lost connection.
Slides you need to put it again.
Yeah, I'll do that. Yeah, okay. So again, results. The important aspect is do not duplicate what's in the table. Don't provide new information or something that you haven't given before. Decimals. If you're giving age, don't give 63.26. Nobody measures age in 0.26. Stop at the decimal, which is logical. 0.2 is fine. 0.26 is never fine. You don't measure age in that 0.26. When you're writing p-values, try to use exact p-values and give confidence interval. Don't just say less than 0.05. Less than 0.05 has a very wide range. And again, since I'm not doing a research methodology class, I'm not going through these details. I'm just going to give you the basics of writing a paper. In a research methodology class, we'll talk about what are the various p-values and CIs. When you do tables and figures, make sure that a table is complete. Again, I'm not going to teach you how to make a table. There are enough tutorials on it. All I'm trying to give you here is how you should structure your paper. So don't repeat text with figures. Make sure your table is complete and accurate. Information should not be different between what's in your table and what's in your text. Now we come to the discussion section. And discussion is where we often make our biggest mess. This is where you have to use your brains and you have to use your own language. Remember, a discussion is not just a random copying of what somebody else wrote. Discussion means putting what you found into perspective. We found that lateral onlay urethroplasty was better than a dorsal onlay urethroplasty, or a ventral onlay urethroplasty was better than a dorsal onlay. What does it mean? How does it translate? You could say simply that we found that a skin incision was more cosmetic, but we found it to be more dangerous. We found it easier to do. We found that our residents are able to learn it. This is different from the Western population because our patients are not circumscribed. We can use preputial skin, therefore it makes it easier. Whatever be the perspective of your paper, write that. Don't just say, we found 4% complication, X found 5%, Z found 8%, Y found 3%. We found 80% success rate, Y found 90%, Z found 20%. That's useless. That's not the objective. You do have to show what others found, but what is the value of how yours is different? How does it matter if you found 6, somebody else found 7, another person found 5? How does it make a difference? What you have to say is, why is yours important in the context of why somebody else did it? And you must always list your limitations. Now, don't create limitations just for the heck of it. Just because I've said you have to write a limitation, don't create a list of 20 limitations. But if there are genuine limitations, list them. Again, practical points on how to write the discussion. Usually the first point, you should just summarize your most important finding. We found this to be the point, this, and this. Paras next 2 to 5, 6 should discuss each of your endpoint. If your primary endpoint was success rate, discuss success. Secondary endpoint was cosmetic outcomes, discuss cosmetic outcomes. Tertiary outcome was lack of complications, discuss lack of complications. Whatever be your endpoints, discuss each endpoint paragraph wise. Compare it with others, but also most importantly, tell people why this is important. And then finally, write your limitations. Then we come to the conclusions. A very important aspect of conclusions is restrict your conclusions only to what you studied. And here I'll give the example of lasers versus TURP because I think it's very appropriate. You compared HOLEP versus TURP in a study. You found HOLEP had good results. You say we found HOLEP had as good fluorescence after TURP. And we also think it's a cost-effective measure. Now, hang on a second. Did you actually study cost? Just because you think it is cost-effective, just because you have a machine and it's cheap, doesn't mean that it's less expensive. If you didn't study it, don't put it in your conclusions. Don't extrapolate results. Just sentences. Don't repeat everything. And that's it. Next aspect is references. Again, this is where everybody tries to take a shortcut. Nobody wants to spend time doing it. And that bugs the editor and the reviewer. Your references must be correct. And again, a practical advice. Search for the reference on PubMed. Use the PubMed citation tool. PubMed now has changed over the last 1 year. The citation tool has become very easy. They give you the citation in text. Copy that citation from PubMed and put that in your paper. That way you will ensure that your reference is complete. It's a very important thing because today automated softwares look at your references. And if a software says that 10 of his 12 references can't be found, the editor is going to throw you out. Therefore, spend time, put in the important references, read the full paper. Remember, if you're quoting a paper, don't quote it from an abstract or just a conclusion, you may be wrong. And again, you're going to bug the reviewer. Don't do that. Try and use the most recent references. Don't go back 20 years to quote something just because it is in favor of what you're saying. Look for the most recent references. The abstract part, just basic tips. I'm not going to go into details on the abstract. Always write the abstract at the end. When you're writing a paper which has, let's say, six authors, you have two faculty, three faculty of different departments, and everybody is going to contribute to your paper. My practical advice to everybody is write your paper, send it on email to everybody. Let everybody give their inputs. Keep modifying it in track changes mode with email to everybody so everybody has seen it. Once everybody, and I know most people will do nothing. Most people won't even reply to your email. I understand that as a practical answer, but even if they don't reply to your email, you've done your job. You've given them the opportunity. Now they don't want to reply. That's their problem. You've done your job. Once it's ready for submission, I mean, not ready for submission, but the final aspect, then write the modification in your paper, which you failed to carry out your abstract, and then there is a discrepancy between the abstract and the text, and that's again very difficult to justify. So write it at the end. Must include at least the most important aspects, so the primary endpoint and how what your results were, and don't give any information in the abstract that's not also given in your text. There should be no new information in your abstract. The last aspect is this submission. Again, cardinal rules to avoid misconduct. You can only submit to one journal at a time. You cannot submit to more than one journal at a time. I know you'll get rejection 8 times out of 10, but you have to wait for that rejection or a decision before you can go to somebody else. You can't go to 4 and assume I will just go with the first person who accepts and I will cut down my waiting time. That is cheating. Don't do it. Spend time improving it. Don't assume I'll submit, get the reviewer's comments and then make it better. That means you've already accepted a loss. Make your first submission the best. And I, again, giving you a human nature answer, I've been editing for dozen years now. The first time an editor or a reviewer reads the paper, he's almost made up his mind that this looks what I want to take it. Just the first time that he reads the paper. The first time I, as an editor, read the paper, I read virtually every paper that gets submitted to the IJU before it goes out. I at least read parts of it. To a large extent, my mind is made up that this paper looks good. Let's see where it goes. And very often, the very first reading, if it is written poorly, you'd say, this guy hasn't done a good job. I don't think it's going very far. Let's see how it goes. And you've already biased your editor or your reviewer with the very first reading. So don't think that I'll wait for the reviewer's comments and then improve my revision. You may not get that chance. Spend time, make your first manuscript the best. Run a grammar check. Nothing is more irritating if you've got the spelling of your primary experiment wrong. If you've written Escherichia, E. coli and Escherichia itself is written incorrectly, you're dead. Your paper is dead. That means you're a very lax person. So check for accuracy, run the spell check. So this was the core about writing a paper. Now I'm going to deviate a bit and cover some of the other aspects. I don't see too many questions. I do see some questions. If it's okay with you, I'll take them at the end because I don't think they're very specific to each point that I'm covering. So I'm going to take them all at the end and we'll have an interaction. I'll finish in the next 8 to 10 minutes. Plagiarism. I know all of you have now heard about it. Now it's been taught in school. 10 years ago, we had to teach MCH students what plagiarism was. Today, we don't have to do that, fortunately. You all know about it. What you must realize is that plagiarism is very broad. Just copying that picture that you think from Campbell's you can copy is not okay. Anything that you take from somewhere else must be with approval of that person. It's not enough to put a citation after it. If you're copying something from somewhere verbatim, or it's an image or a table, you have to take permission. So you can't copy anybody's work. There is an extension of plagiarism, which is called self-plagiarism, which means you can't even copy your own work, which means if you've published a review paper, you can't publish another review paper with the same material. You have to rewrite it. Now, I know it's very difficult to write the same thing on 5 papers and you're writing 5 papers. It's difficult. You have to do it. The rules are being changed over the years. There are a lot of editorial bodies which are really looking at this concept of self-plagiarism. Most people think it's an oxymoron. How can I copy myself? But nonetheless, the rules today state that if you published a paper, you can't copy from your own paper. It's very common for us to see this. All journals now run plagiarism check. The IJU runs a plagiarism check on every manuscript before it's accepted. And not only will it get your paper rejected, most journals maintain a list of people who have misconduct against the IJU has a list of people who submit manuscripts with misconduct. And if we believe you are somebody who does misconduct, you are very unlikely to find favor with us. Therefore, I would advise you, when you read something, it seems so beautifully written, you think it's easy to just do that. You can't say it better. Don't do it. And run your manuscript through at least a free journal submit, even if you don't run it through Authenticate, which is a paid service. The next thing I wanted to talk to you about are predatory journals. And again, this is a huge problem. These are what we call fake journals. Let's understand a basic issue. All of us know that publication is difficult. It's not easy to get a paper accepted. And therefore, there are a number of these people who run web journals and they say, just give me some money and I will publish your paper. It's not very large. Sometimes it's just $1,000, $2,000. And you say, what's the big deal? I can easily afford $2,000. Sometimes it's even just $5,000. I'll pay and get my paper published. Why is this wrong? Why can't I do it? The reason is what I showed you right at the beginning of this talk. The issue of trust. What you write is very rarely cross-checked. The only people who are checking it for validity are the reviewers. They are the only people who are spending time. You think they're hampering you, which is a fact, and peer review, of course, is a very flawed process. Nonetheless, it's the only scrutiny that goes into your paper to even assess whether this work was ever done. I know cheats get through even other ways. Despite all the peer review, we've had people who've actually done 10 cases. We published 1,000. We get it every other week. But at least there is some attempt at ensuring that what gets published has some scientific merit. And the only way that gets done is through peer review. When you bypass peer review because you're in a hurry, because you're getting rejected 5 times, you're now frustrated, and somebody is offering you a simple solution, just pay me the money and I can bypass the peer review. That is cheating. Because the hallmark of scientific publication is this peer review. Again, I repeatedly say peer review is flawed. Every week I come to know of papers that be rejected but get accepted somewhere else. Virtually every paper gets accepted. And there are times when we reject papers that actually get published in better journals than what we consider ourselves to be. It happens. It's an inherent fault of peer review. Ultimately, you're only being judged by two other people and they come with their own biases and their own knowledge. But at least there is some scrutiny of what is happening. On the other hand, when it goes out into a published paper, all your newspapers are willing to take it. Your lay public has no idea. And even half of your own colleagues have no idea what a paper is all about. And they'll just read it and quote it. Therefore, peer review becomes important. Bypassing this by only paying is called predatory or pseudo journals. Remember, paying a journal is not cheating. Many good journals will write you to pay. Even PLOS One will make you pay, BMJ will make you pay, but you can't get published because you pay. Try paying the money and say, I know my paper is trash, but I'll pay you and publish it, they'll throw you out. So you still have to pay them. Paying them doesn't make them bad. But if a journal doesn't peer review you and publishes you just because you pay, that is bad. Therefore, remember that paying to publish is not bad, paying to bypass peer review is bad. And unfortunately, many of the predatory or pseudo journals do that. Dr. Sood was mentioning this about interviews that he and I have sat on together for faculty. And we are so appalled to see people showing their CVs with 10 publications, 20 publications. And having been in this business now for so many years, we can identify what looks like a pseudo journal. And we ask them, how much did you pay to publish? I paid 2,000 rupees. If you pay 2,000 rupees to publish, I guarantee it's a pseudo journal. It's not a good journal that is asking you to pay. And therefore, you lose points. Even if you are otherwise a good person, you lose points because we don't want you as a teacher. If this is what you're going to teach your students, that you can publish like this, we don't want you as a teacher. So there are lots of features of predatory journals. I'm not going to spend more time on predatory journals here. I only wanted to warn you, be aware of this problem. Remember a very common saying in life. If somebody promises that he will double your money tomorrow, there is something seriously wrong. Therefore, all things which look simple and straightforward and help you bypass a tedious process are generally not the right path. The other common issues we see in manuscripts are things like data manipulation, which means you've done 10 cases but written 100. You've done 20 cases, the first three died, you only write about the next 17, you omit the first three who died. Image manipulation, we've seen patients where laparoscopy, they claim that we've done, we put in 3 5 mm ports, but the image comes back with having 2 10 mm ports inside it. Therefore, we know the data is fault. There are times when people say we've randomization, and then we ask them about the, what is one series of 20 patients, 15 authors. The author, his wife, his son-in-law, everybody is an author on that paper. Your science may have been good, your data may have been good, but if you do such kind of misconduct, you've already lost that trust that the reviewer and the editor has in you. And remember, we're talking about a business that deals entirely on trust. Therefore, sometimes it's very difficult to put your finger on why I want to reject this paper. You say the data looks nice, the writing is good. I don't trust this. I know what he's done is cheating, and I'm just going to look for a reason to reject him because I don't trust him. Therefore, in this particular business that we're talking about, faith, trust, honesty, are not just words from an old age, are not just words from a dictionary, they matter a lot. I wanted to talk about impact factors. I'm going to avoid it for now. Simply tell you that the only impact factor that matters is the impact factor given by an organization called Thomson Reuters. It's an impact factor published in the Journal Citation Reports or JCR. It's not just a random impact factor that everybody on the Nukkad can give it to you. There's something called a Pavlov impact factor, an Indian impact factor. What's this guy's name in Poland? Index Copernicus impact factor. This is all fraud. The only impact factor which is still acceptable as a measure of quality is an impact factor given by Thomson Reuters for journals listed in the Science Citation Index Expanded. And the IJU itself is not listed there. So actually the IJU does not have a Science Citation Index impact factor. Therefore, you have to be very careful of when you accept somebody who says that they have an impact factor. Final take-home slide, plan a paper. It's not easy to write a paper, but the most crucial step is the actual research. If the research was bad, you're going to find it very difficult to sell your study. On the other hand, if the research was good, but your language is bad, you will probably still be able to sell your study. You must be systematic in your approach to writing a paper. And I've given you some of those checklist points on how checklists need to be filled to write that paper. Control C, Control V, copy paste. Avoid it. It's the best way of avoiding misconduct and plagiarism. And be ready for revisions. You will have to revise. If you've been accepted for the very first time, we consider it akin to a hole in one in golf. You'll probably get one in a lifetime if you're lucky. So thank you once again for the opportunity and for listening to me. I've tried to keep it down to about 45 minutes. I think I've exceeded that 45 minutes briefly. But I would be really happy if you have questions to ask so that we can actually take something significant. Thank you. Dr. Chawla, it's over to you.
Rajiv, yeah, this, I'll take a few questions. The one question is, I think, is from Dr. Joseph Philippraz. I don't know if it's a comment or a question. Statistical analysis should be clearly written before doing the study. It cannot be like appropriate test will be done. I think this is probably the answer to another chat question. Then there is a question from Anshuman. What is the importance of sample size calculation? And how will it be met if we define the time duration of the study and not the number of patients to be enrolled?
Yeah, very good question. It's asked very frequently. You see, a sample size is crucial to a study which is comparing outcomes. For you to be able to say, again, I'll go into very brief statistics. For you to be able to say that, let's say, HOLEP is different from TURP, there is something called population and samples. If you don't take a big enough sample, your differences may not be significant. And therefore, calculating a sample size, if you're doing a prospective study, particularly a comparative study, is crucial. Then comes the question of how do I fit it into my time period? And that's where most MCH and DNB theses become a problem. When you go to a statistician with a sample size calculation, let's say I want to compare tamsulosin with sildenafil tamsulosin with tadalafil for BPH. And I want a sample size calculation. You may come back and say that if you're looking for an IPSS difference of 2, you will need to recruit 2,000 subjects. And there you're stuck. How do I get 2,000 subjects? Therefore, when we do MCH and DNB thesis, we tend to do studies where the sample size is likely to be manageable within the period in which they're doing the study. Sample size and period recruitment are mutually exclusive. You cannot say I'm going to recruit a sample size of 200 and my study period is 2 years. It can't be. You are going to say either my sample size is 200. It may take you 6 months to recruit it. It may take you 6 years. The period cannot be defined if your sample size is defined. On the other hand, you could say, I will recruit everybody who comes to me in the next 2 year period, in which case your sample size is not defined. Therefore, defining both cannot be done in a study, but you plan your sample size. Sorry, Brady, you need to mute yourself. Yeah, thanks. So sample size should be planned for an MCH and DNB, knowing how much time. Okay, Shavla again.
Yeah, can I come to the next question?
Yeah.
Please keep, there's a background noise. Please keep yourself muted. We are in the important question hour session. Yeah, this question from Vinay. He has asked about the deficiency of what you can say in a language, English language, so how to overcome that, especially in the context of writing a manuscript.
Again, a very good question. And I sympathize with everybody, particularly in this country, who find it often difficult to write in English. It's a very honest question. Again, an honest answer. A well-written paper, unfortunately, does increase your chance of getting accepted. The better the language, the better it is written, certainly does improve your chance of getting an acceptance. On the other hand, good journals will give a value to good science. Even if your science is good and you're able to convey what you wish to convey, many journals will spend time to improve your paper.
I think there's a connectivity issue. Dr. Keshav, can you hear him?
Sir, we can't hear.
Okay. I just ask him to repeat the answer. Yeah, thank you, Gajan. Dr. Rajiv?
Can I audible again?
Yeah.
I think I got lost.
We lost touch. Can you repeat the answer?
So the second part was, how can I make it better? There are now professional services available who can help you make it better. I am not recommending them. I would strongly suggest you use the help of one of your friends and colleagues to make it better. But if you really have no choice, there are professional services available which can help you make English language better. But always acknowledge such help in your manuscript. Make sure you write it at the time of submission that my language correction was done by such and such paid service. And that paid service should only be used to improve language and not to write your paper. So that's some of the key things you have to be careful about. But again, I'm not recommending it, certainly not to a resident. Residents must write their own papers and take the help of their teachers, friends, wives, girlfriends, whosoever you want, to make your paper better. Avoid paid services.
Another question is from Sumant. It's a general question. What is the average time taken from submission to being published? Now, from editor's point of view, what is your take on it?
Good question. Again, very variable. It depends entirely on the resources available to the journal. We divide journals into two types, small journals and regular journals. Small journals are like the IJ. We consider ourselves small journals where everybody is working honorary, nobody gets paid. We have longer periods of time. We try and ensure that we get the first answer back within 8 to 12 weeks. If you've not been rejected outright, your typical outright rejections happen within the first 2 weeks of submission. That means happening at the level of the editor or the associate editor, typically you get a rejection within the first 2 weeks. If you've survived that, we would want to give you your first answer back within the next 8 to 12 weeks. From that point onwards, it is very, very depends on how much was the revision that before weeks. If the revisions were extensive and it required 3 to 4 back and forths, we can't tell you how long it's going to be. From the point of it being accepted, in our language, it's called pre-accepted, which means we have now said that this is okay, we now need to work on it. For the IJU, typically you will get published in the next issue. The IJU currently has 0 manuscripts pending for publication. I think we only have 2 accepted manuscripts currently pending for publication that will appear in the next issue. So we have 0 pendency of accepted manuscripts, but that's only after you've been accepted. For bigger journals, they have far more resources. The timings are much shorter. I expect you would get your answer back from beginning to end within 12 weeks.
Yeah, this question from Sanjay Surekha. His question is, do we need to keep the statistician in the author list for a prospective study, even if he's involved during the beginning of preparation of the, what you can say, protocol and methodology?
Very good question. We get this question at every authorship workshop. We also get the same question about the pathologist, the radiologist, and the microbiologist. Should I keep them or should I not keep them? I would strongly advise you to read the International Committee of Medical Journal Editor Guidelines on Authorship, icmje.org. They have guidelines on authorship. What it basically means is that this is a subjective decision. If the statistician just did routine work, did a sample size calculation, gave it to you, ran a t-test, ran a chi-square, ran an ANOVA, gave it to you, doesn't understand anything about the paper, gave you no scientific inputs, you don't need his name. On the other hand, if the statistician told you what study to do, made you change your plan, told you don't do a prospective, this is how you should do randomization, your sample size will be very large if you do this, look at this endpoint, your sample size will change, which means he has given you inputs without which your paper won't get published. And nobody else would have given you those inputs, given the authorship. So it's unfortunately very subjective. I can't give you a yes or a no answer. Like most things in authorship, I can't give you a yes or a no answer, but I can give you honest guidelines. And if you're honest to yourself, you would be able to say, I think this guy deserves it, or I think this guy doesn't deserve it.
Another question is from Dr. Jaspreet. He has quoted his experience with the Indian Journal of Surgery. So he's asking that in spite of waiting for 100 days, if you don't get an answer from the editorial office, what they should be doing, withdraw or continue?
See, the Indian Journal of Surgery, again, is actually a small journal. It's being run by a full-time surgeon. Dr. Sandeep Kumar I know him very well, dedicated person. The problem is all small journals have limited resources. And 100 days certainly is very long from an author's perspective. But I would be dishonest if I said I didn't have manuscripts sitting with the IJU, which also at times would have crossed 100 days. We wish to avoid it. We proactively We proactively try to answer and move it. But sometimes it happens. Should you continue? Should you not? Again, is an answer you have to give. I'll give you an author's perspective answer. If my manuscript has sat with the journal for 100 days, I think my chances of acceptance are higher than if it has sat there only for 20 days. I would generally persist. And if I was happy with the journal that I had that is taking 100 days, I would sit for a few more days unless it is critical for me to get it back. Because again, now this is a very unscientific answer, but this is an answer from an author's perspective, not an editor's perspective. But the longer that my manuscript sits with the journal, I tend to feel the higher is my chances of getting accepted in that journal. So don't submit it anywhere else. If that's the question you're asking me, do not submit it anywhere else until you have withdrawn it and you've got an acceptance of withdrawal. But whether you wish to pursue with them is entirely your choice. 100 seems long, but unfortunately, it's not uncommon.
This question from Gajanan, Dr. Gajanan, but the most common causes for rejection of a manuscript. You can enlist the top three causes.
The first common is there's nothing new in the manuscript. The first common reason why papers get rejected is what you are presenting is not new. There are 20 other studies which have looked at exactly that. That is the commonest reason. No new information, nothing new to be presented. Second most common reason for rejection is that your methodology cannot answer the question that you are aiming to answer, which means that you are looking at complication of a surgery, but you only followed up for 30 days. You are looking at success of radical prostatectomy for prostate cancer, but your follow-up is 36 months only. You are looking at biochemical recurrence after prostate cancer surgery, but your follow-up is 12 months. So your methodology cannot answer the primary objective. That is point number two. The third common is misconduct. So I would probably put it down to those three reasons. Misconduct means we don't trust what's there. Very difficult to prove misconduct. When plagiarism is the easiest thing to prove. The other kind of misconduct is very difficult to prove. I can't really prove that you only had 10 patients, but you're writing about 100. But urology in India is a small community. We tend to know most people, most centers. So if a small center in a small city sends me a data of 1,000 RARPs, I have enough background knowledge to say, lagta nahi hai. So then that's the third commonest reason.
The question from Dr. Rohit, can you mention a software where the manuscript can be run for basic corrections before submission on their own? They can manage?
No, there is no website which will correct your manuscript for submission. They will check for plagiarism. That's a different matter. You can simply do a Google search. You can do a Turnitin search. You can do an authenticate search, many of them. But to say that your manuscript is good and formatted correctly, I don't know of any website. That's AI, and I don't think any website has invested in AI to that extent.
Dr. Karandeep wants to know what should be mentioned exactly in the cover letter to the editor during the time of submission.
Yeah, cover letters are not essential. Although every journal gives you an opportunity to upload a cover letters are not essential. But cover letters are very essential if you have a conflict of interest. So if there is something very important about your paper that your drug was given by the pharma company, or the device you're describing is a device that you have made and you own shares in it. You've presented the paper somewhere before. Stuff like that. When there's a conflict of interest, that cover letter becomes very important. Secondly, if there is something specific you want to tell the editor, please don't send it to this reviewer. This reviewer is not my friend. I know that he does bad job for me. If you specifically dislike a reviewer, you have a reason to believe a particular set of people or an associate editor, or even the editor himself, you don't trust the editor. Put that in the cover letter, that there are specific reasons that I want to bring your notice to. Otherwise, you can actually, there's nothing very specific in the cover letter. Other than to just give basic facts. We haven't published it before. We are submitting original data and stuff like that.
Yeah, this is another general question. How to get over ethics committee's clearance issues?
First point, you should have an ethics committee which satisfy the ICMR guidelines. Most people don't have it. Their ethics committees don't suit ICMR guidelines. We get plenty of ethics committee reports where a hospital, the person doing the study, it's his father and his mother who are the owners of the ethics committee. So we get ethics committee reports like that. So how do you overcome? You can't overcome. You have to satisfy them. Ethics committees, again, to me, except obviously all of us get bugged when they send your manuscript back and say they do the following things. Your first response is, who the hell are they to ask you this? But at the end of the day, they have a job to do to help make your study better. So you can't overcome them. Try your best to satisfy them. Most of their questions are valid.
This question from Vinod Babu, he has asked, can we mention any new information which they have got during the study, which can be listed at the end, and it was not their defined endpoint of the study or primary or secondary objective or the endpoint? Can this be the reason for rejection?
No. Well, you must write that. If you found something relevant, even though it wasn't your endpoint, but you found something important, you must mention it. It will never be a reason for rejection. However, in your methodology, there must be a place which says how you got that information. Like, for example, I gave you that example of HIV. Let's say you were doing a study on stricture urethra, and HIV was not your endpoint, but you suddenly found that 30% of the patients whom you operated upon were HIV positive. And you must mention it is an extremely high number. So you do say, incidentally, we found 30% of our patients were HIV positive. But then in your methodology, you must say that as a part of routine practice, we test for HIV in every one of our patients. So many hospitals don't. For example, my hospital, we don't test for HIV. So if I was to submit a paper and say that we found 30% HIV, my immediate question to my co-author would be, we never test. How did you find this out? Then it must have been a part of your study, which you are not mentioning. Therefore, finding a new, you must mention it if it is significant. But at the same time, your methodology must explain how you found that.
There's a question from Shruti Pandit. She wants to know about the literature review. Her question is, can you suggest a streamlined process to do a literature search?
Now we are mixing thesis with paper writing.
Absolutely.
In a paper writing, you don't do literature research, a literature search. This you need to do for your thesis. For your thesis, again, the advice I will give you is the advice I give to residents who are writing a thesis with me. Your literature search is based on your endpoints. What are you trying to study? Let me give an example of a thesis I recently asked one of my residents to do. It's on PCNL. So I specifically asked him to look at what is the published literature on this technique? Why should we use this technique? What is the literature? What is the anatomy of the kidney? What is the literature? So your literature search is always based on what are the questions you're trying to study for your thesis and find what work has been done in the past. One, to make sure that your hypothesis is valid, and two, to make sure you're not doing something which 20 other people have already published. So literature search comes there, not at the time of writing the paper.
Dr. Kabilan wants to know that how to get a consent of a patient in a retrospective study.
You never get consent of a patient in a retrospective study. If you're writing a retrospective study and you say we took consent of the patient for the study, you're lying. When a patient comes into a hospital for a surgery, where surgeons are going to talk about surgery, he gives consent for that surgery. Many hospitals at the time of admission also take consent for storage of data in an HIS and retrieval for future research. Many hospitals don't, which is perfectly fine. In a retrospective study, when you say consent, what you mean is that the patient gave informed written consent for undergoing the procedure that we are describing. If at the same time your hospital does have a policy of taking consent for storage of data and retrieval for research, you can mention that as a policy, a hospital takes consent from all patients for storage of data and retrieval for research. Many hospitals don't. And then the consent simply means patients consented for undergoing the procedure that is being described in this study.
This is a question from Dr. Paul. He wants to know whether retrospective studies are considered inferior to the prospective ones.
The answer again is yes and a no. For anything which can be done prospectively, a retrospective study is inferior. For anything which potentially you can do prospectively also, doing a retrospective study is invariably inferior. But there are certain research pieces which cannot be done prospectively. For example, I'll give you something from outside urology. Let's look at exposure of asbestos and the development of mesothelioma. If you were to look at all patients who are exposed to asbestos, follow them prospectively to see how many develop mesothelioma, you'll need three generations of each one of you to find out how many mesotheliomas occur, because the occurrence is so rare that a prospective study will never be able to get the answer. Therefore, the only way is to look at all people who have mesothelioma today and go back and see how many of them had exposure to asbestos in the past. That's what's called a case control study, which is a retrospective study. So in such conditions, a retrospective study is the only study that you can do. So when the occurrence is uncommon or the outcome takes a very long time to occur, the best option is a case control or a retrospective study. But on the other hand, for any research which can be finished in a finite period of time, a prospective study will always be better than a retrospective study. And for most studies in urology, it is very difficult to say that a retrospective study was better than a prospective study for most studies. But it's not axiomatic. It's not always one of them.
Yeah, this is a question from Dr. Naman. He's asking, sometimes even quoting a published manuscript can come as a faulty. So the best way to overcome plagiarism, in your opinion, will be what?
I didn't understand that. Can I just...
He's asking what is the best way to overcome plagiarism, because there are strict rules. Even a published manuscript, even you put as a reference, can come as a faulty during the checkup.
Yes, you cannot... Right. So... when you are citing somebody else, you always put a reference number at the end of it. So and so found so much and such complication. That is standard. You have to quote somebody. But you can't quote them. You can't copy from their results and put it in your paper. You have to read their paper, understand what they are saying, write it in your own words, and then give a citation that this is somebody else's research work and this is a citation. How can you avoid it? Best way is not to copy paste. Read, understand, write in your own language. How to check that you haven't done it? Do a regular plagiarism check software. There are some of them which are free. Turnitin is free, or otherwise paid software such as Authenticate. So prevention as well as checking after you've written.
And Dr. Rajiv, the question from Dr. Ganesh, if the reviewers, peer reviewers differ in their opinion, how does the editor decide in conveying the decision? Yeah.
Very good question. And it happens every single day. This is the inherent fault of peer review that I talked about. Routinely, there are three reviewers, one says accept, one says reject, the third guy says I don't know. Very common. What an editor does is never look at how many ticks and how many crosses there are. That is the worst way for an editor to work. Three people said yes, two people said no, majority vote, three people said yes, accept. Pathetic way of being an editor. An editor is required to read the reviews as to why has this person said no? Why has this person said yes? There may be a person who has just written two sentences, good work, never previously written, except. On the other hand, another guy says, this paper has 30% plagiarism, reject. That one rejection will outweigh four other people who've said accept. And that single guy who said accept will carry no weight. Therefore, you don't total up what are the yeses and noes. You read what is the reason they're recommending accept. What is the reason they're recommending reject? And you make an educated decision based on the recommendation. And if you don't think there are enough reviews, you get more. That's why it often takes time. People send a review which simply says, excellent paper, please accept. Another guy says, pathetic hypothesis, reject. They're useless reviews for us. So unless somebody gives a reason as to why they're saying something, the review doesn't work. And it's not a democratic process. You don't total up the yeses and noes. You have to read why they're saying so. And then take a decision.
Dr. Rajiv, in your experience, is the order of writing the authors for a publication matters?
Again, very good question. We get this very honestly. Again, an honest answer. Yes, it does matter. Particularly if you're in an educational institution and you're looking for promotions and stuff like that, I will simply quote to you the Medical Council of India guidelines. If you're really interested in this work, there are two editorials we've published as multiple authors. They've appeared in the IJU also. For the MCI, there are editorials which have appeared in 22 journals, Indian journals. We were one of the authors we published in the IJU. We talk about all this. The bottom line is, for recognition today, the first author is generally believed to be the person who has done the maximum amount of work. And as a good academician, as a faculty, we would normally give it to the resident who's done the work. That's the first author. The senior author is what we call the corresponding author. That is the person who probably conceptualized it, who is the faculty involved, the senior most person, not necessarily head of the department, not necessarily senior most because he's the oldest, but the person for whom this work was the principal work, he would generally be the corresponding author. So first author, corresponding author are the two important positions on the byline. This is a real world answer. If I was speaking at an editor's conference, my answer would be no, it doesn't matter. Everybody is equal. But a real world answer for most of the people on this platform, yes, it matters, first and corresponding.
Dr. Rajiv, there's a question from Jivtesh. If you have a retrospective study with a very long follow-up, can this be suitable for acceptance by a journal?
Again, any retrospective study is acceptable for a journal. It's not just on how long the follow-up was. You may be answering a very important question, but you realized it after you've done the surgery. Let's say 10 patients came in. I'll give you an example of a clinical combined round we had at Ames today. There were these two patients where they found strange findings on the brain imaging. Patients presented with quadriparesis, paraparesis, quadriparesis. They did an MR. They found some strange findings. They went back and pulled out the case sheets and thought that they could correlate it with COVID. Maybe they could, maybe they couldn't, but it's a retrospective study. They realized that there was an important finding after everything had been done, but it's very important. There are two cases that will probably get published. So just because it is retrospective doesn't mean it is bad. I'll again give the same answer. If this research could have been done prospectively, let's look at the complications of urethroplasty as an example again. If you give me a retrospective study saying my complications of onlay versus inlay urethroplasty, a retrospective study, it's a much poorer study than when somebody saying, I'm going to look at complications of onlay versus inlay urethroplasty prospectively. So a research which can be done prospectively, but wasn't done, and you're looking at it retrospectively, isn't as good. But that doesn't mean every retrospective study is bad.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Rajiv. That was from the chat box. Again, dear agents, colleagues, and all the members, excellent presentation, very simple, concise, and covering very relevant, practical, and pertinent issues, I think, which are useful not only for agent, but for the young members and consultants who are interested in scientific writing and submission their work to various journals. And with this, I hand over to first Dr. Keshav and then to Dr. Rajiv for the closing remarks.
Thank you, Dr. Rajiv Kumar, for a wonderful lecture. And it was very interactive. I think a lot of them had their doubts cleared and you have given them the answers perfectly right. And thank you very much for your time. It was a wonderful evening. I would now request Dr. Rajiv Sood to give his closing remarks. Over to you, Dr. Rajiv.
Thank you, Dr. Keshav. I think this was very fruitful discussion. And Dr. Rajiv Kumar, as usual, has covered the topic excellently. And residents today are truly benefited in their concepts, perception. It will go a long way. And this lecture is going to be archived also, and it is available for everybody, this kind of interaction, which will be the game changer for Urological Society of India. And Dr. Rajiv, again, is to be congratulated. He has done a Herculean job and very well served. Thank you very much. Thank you, Rajiv.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for the invitation again.
Thank you, Dr. Sood. Thank you, Dr. Keshav. Good night, everybody. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.